difference with the heat. We have warm, low, medium, and high. Okay. Do that. That's usually the temperature. So cold, so warm. I meant to say I hate being cold. Going to bed. And then I have two things. So it will both be applied on your eyes. It's those two things, but you can just choose which one you like. So this one makes really nice sound. We can choose by the sound. That's fair. A lot of people, animals, and sure, apparently. All right. The first question was how to get dry again. They had a consultation about this, and after a few minutes, it seemed quite natural to Alice to find herself talking familiarly with them, as if she had known them all her life. Indeed, she had quite a long argument with the Laurie, who at last turned sulky and would only say, "I'm older than you and must know better." And this Alice would not allow, without knowing how old it was, and as the Laurie positively refused to tell its age, there was no more to be said. Said Alice, not that she much wanted to know, but the Dodo had both. closed as if it thought that somebody ought to speak, and no one else seemed inclined to say anything. "Why," said the Dodo, "the best way to explain it is to do it. And as you might like to try to think yourselves and win today, I will tell you how the Dodo managed it. First, it marked out a race course in a sort of circle. The exact shape doesn't matter," it said. "And then all the party were placed along the course here and there. There was no 1, 2, 3 in a way, but they began running when they liked and left off when they liked, so that it was not easy to know when the race was over. However, when they had been running half an hour or so, and were quite dry again, the Dodo suddenly called out, 'The race is over,' and they all crowded round it, panting and asking, 'But who has won?' This question the Dodo could not answer without a great deal of thought, and it stood for a long time with one pressed finger upon its forehead, the position in which you usually see Shakespeare in the pictures of him, while the rest waited in silence. At last, the Dodo said, 'Everybody has won, and all must have prizes. But who is to give the prizes?' Quite a chorus of voices asked. 'Why, she, of course,' said the Dodo, pointing to Alice with one finger, and the whole party at once crowded round her, calling out in a confused way, 'Prizes! Prizes!' Alice had no idea what to do, and in despair, she put her hand in her pocket and pulled out a box of comfits. Luckily, the salt water had not gotten to it, and handed them around as prizes. There was exactly one apiece all around. 'But she must have a prize herself, you know,' said the mouse. 'Of course,' the Dodo replied very gravely. 'What else have you got in your pocket?' it went on, turning to Alice. 'Only a thimble,' said Alice sadly. 'Hand it over here,' said the Dodo. Then they all crowded round her once more, while the Dodo solemnly presented the thimble, saying, 'We beg your acceptance of this elegant thimble.' And when it had finished this short speech, they all cheered. Alice thought the whole thing very absurd, but they all looked so grave that she did not dare to laugh, and as she could not think of anything to say, she simply bowed and did the thimble, looking as solemn as she could. The next thing was to eat the comfits. This caused some noise and confusion, as large birds complained that they could not taste theirs, and the small ones choked and had to be patted on the back. However, it was over at last, and they sat down again in a ring and begged the mouth to tell them something more. 'You promised to tell me your history, you know,' said Alice, 'and why it is you hate CND.' She added in a whisper, half afraid that it would be offended again. 'Mine is a long and sad tale,' said the mouse, turning to Alice and sighing. 'It is a long tale, certainly,' said Alice, looking down with wonder at the mouse's tail. 'But why do you call it sad?' And she kept on puzzling about it while the mouse was speaking, so that her idea of the tale was something like this. It looks like this. I think I have to show it. It looks like this. Furry said to a mouse that he met in the house, 'Let us both go to law. I will prosecute you. Come, I'll take no denial. We must have a trial. For really, this morning, I've nothing to do, said the mouse to the cur. Such a trial, dear sir, with no jury or judge, would be wasting our breath. I'll be judge, I'll be jury, said cunning old furry. I'll try the whole cause and condemn you to death. This is happy. I hope you're gonna have good night with some good dreams, not nightmares, dreams. Here's a little picture of Alice with the dodo and the rest of the animals. You are not attending, said the mouse to Alice severely. What are you thinking of? I beg your pardon, said Alice very humbly. You had got to the fifth bend, I think. I had not, cried the mouse sharply and very angrily. A knot, said Alice, always ready to make herself useful and looking anxiously about her. Oh, do let me help to undo it. I shall do nothing of the sort, said the mouse, getting up and walking away. You insult me by talking such nonsense. I didn't mean it, pleaded poor Alice, but you're so easily offended, you know. The mouse only growled in reply. Please come back and finish your story, Alice called after it, and the others all joined in chorus. But the mouse only shook its head impatiently and walked a little quicker. What a pity it wouldn't stay inside the lorry as soon as it was quite out of sight. And an old crab took the opportunity of saying to her daughter, oh, my dear, let this be a lesson to you never to lose your temper. Hold your tongue, ma, said the young crab a little snappishly. You're enough to try the patience of an oyster. I wish I had our Dina here, you know. Said Alice aloud, addressing nobody in particular. She'd soon fetch it back. And who is Dina, if I might venture to ask the question, said the lorry. Alice replied eagerly, for she was always ready to talk about her pet. Dina's our cat. And she's such a capital one for catching mice, you can't think. And oh, I wish you could see her after the birds. Why, she'll eat a little bird as soon as look at it. This speech caused a remarkable sensation among the party. Some of the birds hurried off at once. One old magpie began wrapping itself up very carefully, remarking, I really must be getting home. Tonight air doesn't suit my throat. And a canary called out in a trembling voice to its children, come away, my dears. It's high time you were all in bed. On various pretexts, they all moved off, and Alice was soon left alone. I wish I hadn't mentioned Dina, she said to herself in a melancholy tone. Nobody seems to like her. Down here. And I'm sure she's the best cat in the world. Oh, my dear Dina, I wonder if I shall ever see you anymore. And here poor Alice began to cry again, for she felt very lonely and low-spirited. In a little while, however, she again heard a little pattering of footsteps in the distance, and she looked up eagerly, half hoping that the mouse had changed his mind and was coming back to finish his story. Oh, chapter 4. Alright. So, Moment and fetch me a pair of gloves and a pan.
Fetch it here, lad. Here, put them up.
Thing she heard was a general chorus of "There goes Bill."